Hey guys, today I've got for you mathematical induction. So an extension topic. I know a lot of you do tend to struggle with induction, but at the same time, it's an important enough topic to kind of know the ins and outs of how to prove an induction question. And once you've actually learned the steps and understand what you're doing with the steps, it's not too hard to get to the result, because I think this is one of those type of questions. It's usually a show proof. So, meaning you know what you're shooting for. Okay, so let's get straight into it. So, if this is the first live stream you've watched, just in terms of the formatting, it is a 1 to 1.5 hour presentation on the topic, uploaded every Monday. This is the last one for the term. So hopefully, if you're getting tested on this topic this term, you'll find this useful. If not, that's perfectly fine. You'll be able to watch it whenever it's relevant to you. So in terms of the resources available to you, I just want to mention a couple of things. I'm just going to switch over to our website just to show you. Okay, so if you come to our website, all the resources are there. So if you go to resources, Pinnacle Life online lessons, so we've run 6 of these already, and we're looking to build more of it next year as well. And if you have any topic suggestions at all, make sure you let me know on the Facebook group. So if you come to the page, so we've done a couple of these ones, so geometric application of calculus, and we've got some parabola, parametrics is a big one for a lot of students who really struggle through this topic. So you can come to induction, which is today's topic. And if you scroll down, basically there's the student booklet. So the student booklet is something you can pre-download, print it out, and it makes it easy to follow the presentation, and you can sort of work through the problems, pause the video, and then, you know, have a look at how I explain the problem. And if you're feeling confident, like, oh yeah, I got this, try the practice set. So these are specially curated questions that I've chosen. I think it's a good selection of some easy range questions as well as some of the more difficult exam type questions. So as I mentioned before, there is a Facebook group. So Facebook group, if you type in Pinnacle Live discussion group, you can be accepted into the group. So this is just a general group that I use to communicate with our students, whether it's just answering questions and things like that. So for example, so very recent post. So for example, this is me answering some of the homework questions from our center homework. So yeah, so basically I'm pretty sure you can figure out how to use Facebook and be creative with it. That's your way to get in touch with me and interact with me, and hopefully give us some feedback or answer, or I can help you answer any questions at all. Right, so getting back to today's presentation. So I've talked about all of that. So this is a relatively new initiative for us. So we're hoping to continuously improve this to make it more useful for you. So a little bit about me, if you don't know who I am, I'm the co-founder of Pinnacle Coaching College. So I've been teaching maths for over a decade now, feeling a little bit old. I personally teach Extension 1, Extension 2 at the college, so you will see me around for those subjects, and I've helped a lot of students in the past achieve great results for the HSC. So I'm hoping to share that knowledge with you. All right, so getting straight into it, what is mathematical induction? A lot of my students like to call it, it's like writing an essay in maths, and I think that pretty much sums up what it is. So just looking through the steps, right? So suppose that some statement is to be proven for all integers n greater than or equal to some starting value, and suppose that it has been proven that. So what we're really doing here is we are following broadly three steps. So instead of just talking through the, I guess, gibberish a little bit, I'm going to explain it to you or the underlying logic behind induction by just giving you an example. Okay, so I think the easiest way to understand this is what we call a summing type of a sequence. So quite often you're proving, for example, so let's say if I wanted to prove T1 plus T2 plus T3 plus Tn is equal to some sum formula Sn. Okay, and to keep things even simpler, so you can sort of conceptualize what I'm talking about here, I'm not going to use the Sn notation. Okay, I'm just going to pick a random formula. Let's say n squared plus 1. Okay, so let's say for some sequence, we wanted to prove that the first term plus the second term plus all the way to the nth term is n squared plus 1. Okay, and usually the question will be pretty explicit about for what value. So let's say for n is greater than or equal to 1. So that's what this stuff is saying. Yeah, that's some starting value. Okay, so step one. It's about you prove true for the first value. So prove true for n equals to 1. All that means really, so this is a summing sequence, right? So if n is 1, you literally just only have the first term. If n is 2, you have first and second term, and so on. So let me just summarize this for you, because I think a lot of people just follow the steps without appreciating why you're adding more terms on. So if n is equals to 1, it means we have T1 is equal to, when n is 1, so 1 squared plus 1 on my definition of the sum, right? If n is equals to 2, then it's technically T1 plus T2 is equal to 2 squared plus 1. That's what we're proving, okay? If n is equals to 3, then it's T1 plus T2 plus T3 is equal to 3 squared plus 1, and so on and so forth. So we're building this sequence. The higher the n value, the more terms you have in the sequence, okay? At least that's generally true for the very basic type that we'll look at. So you start off by proving true for n equals 1, which basically involves sort of showing that process. So i.e. you want to show that T1 is the same as 1 squared plus 1. That's what you want to do, okay? And then step 2 is, I'm just going to summarize this very broadly because obviously this is not a proper question. I just more to explain the logic. So you prove true, sorry. Not prove true, you assume true for n equals to k, and then prove true for the next one. Now this logic is important. Why are we assuming true for k and then proving true for k plus 1? So the idea is actually very, very simple. So if it's true for n equals 1, which we already established, that's basically step 1. Then step 2, by proving that if it's true for k, it's always true for the next one, k plus 1, then on that logic, if it's true for 1, then it's true for n equals 2, 1 plus 1, right? The next one, 2. Then the logic repeats. If it's true for n equals to 2, then it's true for n equals to 2 plus 1, which is 3, and so on and so forth. So that's the induction logic. It's like a sort of a rolling ball process, right? So you show that it's true for the first one, then you show that it's always true for the next one. If you know it's true for the previous one, so it's always true for 1, then it's true for 2. If it's true for 2, it's true for 3. If it's true for 3, it's true for 4, and so on and so forth, all the way to n or whatever value, right? N is greater than some value. So that's the core logic of induction. So hopefully that makes sense. So moving on. And forgot to mention, finally, there's always a conclusion that should be written. Just a bit of note around how conclusions are marked. I'll say nowadays, generally speaking, there's no marks that is directly allocated to a conclusion. So for example, if you started the induction question, you couldn't get to the end, you just couldn't get it to work. I mean, good idea still writing the conclusion regardless, but there's no points for writing a conclusion per se on its own if you haven't got the induction steps correct. But having said that, it's negatively marked. So for example, if you've done all the steps, so you've done your step one, true for n equals one, you've proven the middle part, so true for k, hence true for k plus one, but you didn't write a conclusion, 1 mark that gets deducted. So that's generally been how it's marked. So just be aware of that. Don't give marks away. Yeah, just rote learn or remember some sort of standard conclusion. Just take one from a textbook or take one like that your teacher recommends and just stick with that. All right, so as I mentioned before, there are actually different categories of induction questions. So broadly speaking, in the HSC, there are three types. There's the summing and sequence, which is the logic I was trying to explain a little bit earlier. There's also divisibility as well as inequality. I will say in the extension one paper, you pretty much exclusively only see the first two categories, which is good because they're the easier type. Inequality, I'll say, it's very rare in the extension one paper unless they're feeling super mean in that year. I think I'm only seeing one or two over the last 10, 15 years. Having said that, it's a lot more heavy in the extension two test. So if you do extension two, you might want to pay attention on how to prove inequality inductions. So let's get straight into it. I think with induction, you kind of need to see a question to understand the logic. All right, so let's start with this very basic one. So we've got using mathematical induction, we are trying to prove true for n is greater than or equal to 1, this sequence. So just in terms of how to read the sequence. So this is your first term, right? And this is your second term. This is your third term and so on. And this is your nth term. And this is your Sn formula, basically. Yeah, you're trying to show the sum of first n term can be given by this formula. So the first step, so step one, prove true for n equals to 1. Okay, so how do we do that? Usually on the left hand side, it's literally your first term, yeah, because when n is equal to 1, you're summing one term, right? If you're not sure, this is a little tip from me. Sub n equals 1 into general term, see if it gets you the first term. If it does, that's it, that's your term. Alright, so 1 times 3, 3. Right hand side is 1 on 6, 1 plus 1. 2 times 1 plus 7. I mean, without a calculator, I can tell you it has to be 3. Otherwise, you have a big issue here. So that's 9. So that's 3. Okay, so therefore, left-hand side is equal to right-hand side. Therefore, true for n equals to 1. Okay, so that is it. Step 1 is done. Let's go on to step 2. So step two, I might need a lot more room for this, so let's see. All right, so we're going to assume true for n equals to k, where k is some integer. So literally from here, you just copy the sequence and replace all the n with k. So I'm just going to do that very quickly. Okay, so now we're going to prove if it's true for some value k, we want to prove true for the next one, okay? So prove true for n equals to k plus 1. So first, we want to write out what we're trying to prove, okay? It's never a good idea to do a proof blindly, not knowing what you're shooting for. I always say this to my students. sometimes I can fully appreciate that as a student, you want to save as much time as you can and, you know, trying to skip steps and not write everything out. But if you think about this from a more efficiency, accuracy type of standpoint, right? Let me just put that in. If your attempt to save a few minutes has resulted you in making a mistake, which you then have to go back and try to fix, doesn't that cost you more time? So I think, you know, sometimes you have to balance between, so that's 7 plus 2, 9. Sometimes you have to balance between how quickly you're doing things and how accurately you're doing things, right? If you can achieve both, that's the ideal dream. But if you're sacrificing accuracy at the sacrificing accuracy to achieve speed, then you need to question, well, is that actually what I want as an outcome? Is that actually end up costing me more time to try and go fix mistakes? Yeah. So I think I do find that I have to educate a lot of students sort of this type of thinking. You know, it's not about just getting things done as quickly as possible. If you think about it, you're not marked on being as quickly as possible, right? You're marked for being accurate, like producing correct answers. So keep the ultimate objective in mind and use that to judge what you should do. And I think it's quite important for induction, in the context of induction, to write out all the steps, because quite often I see students, I can't see what is going on, like I just can't see it. And I'm like, well, you just have to write an extra step, then you'll be able to see it. Having that visually in front of you makes a huge difference. Yeah, I guarantee that. All right, so let's try to do this. So I've just simplified the right-hand side a little bit. So all I've done is replace n with k plus 1. So you see it's k plus 1, n with k plus 1. So it becomes k plus 1 plus 1, so k plus 2. And then 2n, so 2k plus 1, and just expand it out. So that's 2k plus 2, and then plus 7, so it's plus 9. All right. This is not going to be good because I'm going to run out of space, but I'll do it in a different color. All right, so this, the blue bit will be the proof. So firstly, we start with the left-hand side. So the left-hand side, now if you sort of look at this, right? This is basically t1 plus t2 plus all the way to tk, and then the next one is tk plus 1. That's what you have, yeah? Every time you go up by 1, you get a new term. So this first part from t1 to tk is using your assumption, okay? So what I'm going to do is just take from the assumption. And then plus the tk plus 1. All right, so that's the first step. So I'll just make a note here using assumption. Yeah, it's always a good idea to note it down. Now then from here, we are trying to get this to look like the right-hand side. We're trying to get it to look like that, okay? Actually, you know what? I might just move that up a little bit. So that is not in the way, because I think right now it is a little, let's see if this thing works. Ah, that works. Okay. I'll just get rid of that. Okay, so that, I've got more room because I definitely need more space here. All right, so then, I would recommend, instead of expanding, especially for these summing types, always factorize. So if you sort of check this, right, k plus 1 is a common factor. So let's take that out first. Okay, and then what I'm going to put As well is, let's put that on 6 as well, so that I can combine this together. All right, so I'm gonna expand the top. Okay, I'm gonna continue. I'll try to keep this all onto one slide. I mean, I'm going to struggle a little bit because induction does take a lot of room, but I'll try. One can only try. Now, without doing factorization, I can already guess what this has to be. It must be 2k plus 2, 2k plus 9. And if it's not, you have a problem, right? But, you know, let's just quickly check the factorization. So it should be 9 and 2. Let's see if we actually get that. So that's 4 and that's 9. 9 plus 4, 13. Okay, that's perfect. And that's it. All right. So therefore, true for n equals to k plus 1. And that is it. That's step 2 done. Now, in terms of step 3. So step 3 is literally a conclusion, right? So in terms of the conclusion, what you could write is something along these lines. I mean, it kind of depends on how condensed of a version your school will accept. So the most sort of condensed version I've seen that's been accepted is, therefore, by mathematical induction, true for all n is greater than or equal to 1. Okay. All right. So then, and probably a longer version could be something like this. All right. So therefore, I can actually you can say something like this. So, following the above induction logic, the sum is true for n equals 1, and when true for some integer n equals to k, it is also true for the next one, n equals to k plus 1. Therefore, true for n equals to 1 plus 1 equals 2, 2 plus 1 equals to 3, etc. Hence, true for all n is greater than or equal to 1. Okay, so you can go something like that as well. This is a much more elaborate description. Literally, this is describing the induction process, but some teachers demand that level of detail, so give whatever they want, right? Because they're going to be marking your papers. But I mean, to be honest, I will just go for the short one, because who wants to write an essay, right? So that is it. So just to go back and have a look at the different steps. So the step 1 is just prove true for n equals 1. So you literally just pick the first term, that's the left hand side, right hand side is when n is 1, that's it. Then the second step is the core step in induction. So you assume true for k, prove true for k plus 1, which means you have an extra term on the left side, and you incorporate the assumption. So assumption, stick that in the front for the sum of the first k terms plus the next term, k plus 1's term. Factorize, and you'll get to the right hand side, and that's it. And finally, make sure you write a conclusion so you don't lose out on the mark. And that is it. Moving on, let's take a look at the next one, which technically is not a summing type of question, but it uses a very similar logic, and this one's actually a lot more difficult than the previous one. I just want to, you know, push the boundaries a little bit, show you some of the more challenging examples so that you know how the logic works. So if you do happen to come across one, hopefully you'll be able to do them. All right, the steps are exactly the same. So this time we're starting from n equals 2. All right, so prove true for n equals 2. All right, so that's step one. Now, again, quickly check, right? If I sub 2 here, do I get the first term? Yes, I do. So that's it, okay? So your left-hand side is equals to 2 squared minus 1. So that's 4 minus 1, which is 3. Right-hand side. Now, if you haven't seen the n factorial notation, just for those people who's like, what in the heck is this exclamation mark? It's not an exclamation mark. That thing is called a factorial notation. Okay, what it means is just n times n minus 1 times n minus 2, until you get down to 1. Let me give you an example. 3 factorial equals to 3, 2, 1. Okay? So that's all it is. If you're like, I've never seen that, I'm not comfortable working with that, well, just replace that with that sequence. Okay? That's all it is. Right-hand side. So we want 2. So 2 factorial square. By the way, there is a factorial button in your calculator. Let me just quickly show you. All right, so depending on your calculator, I don't know if you can see this. So my one is kind of in yellow right there. So for example, 2 factorial should come up like that. Yeah, so you see the exclamation mark sign, so you can just chuck it into the calculator if you don't want to evaluate it manually. But 2 factorial means 2 times 1, so that's 2 square times 3 on 2. Just make sure. Oh, I just realized that it's not right. It's not 2 times 1. Times 2, so that's 4, so that's 3, 4, 4 and 4, 3, okay? Alright, so that's it, so therefore left-hand side is equal to right-hand side, therefore true for n equals to 2, okay? So step 2, assume true for n equals to k. So you just copy this question and just replace n with k. And then prove true for n equals to k plus 1. Alright, so left hand side. Again, let's analyze this. This is sort of the multiplication, so this is not a summing chain, but it works in the same way. So you've got T1 times T2 up to Tk, and then you've got the next term, Tk plus 1, right? So this is the assumption, right? Because this is basically saying T1 times T2 all the way to TK is that. So we're going to copy the assumption. Okay, so that's using assumption. All right, so from here, I am going to expand that second bracket. So 1 and 1 cancels out. So factorize the k out. All right, so I'm trying to keep this on the same page, but it looks like I will have to go onto the new page looking at this. Just before I do that though, if you just do a very quick compare, right? K plus 2, K plus 2, yep, tick, tick. I don't know why there's a random K here, but if you check it, K and K, they can cancel out. Good, I want to get rid of it, okay? Now, also, you need a K plus 1, top and bottom. And you kind of needed that because otherwise you can't have the k plus 1 square factorial because you need to put in a k plus 1 square in there. So with that in mind, actually, you know what? I'll copy this into the next page so we're not lost. So left hand side is equal to so that's what we have so far. So as mentioned, K cancels out, and you will also need to multiply an extra K plus 1, K plus 1 top and bottom to get that K plus 1 on the bottom, and I'm going to show you what's going to happen from here. So that becomes K plus 1 squared, yeah, K plus 1 times K plus 1, and then you've got K plus 2. And this is k factorial times k plus 1 all squared. Right, which becomes k plus 1 factorial because that's the next term, right? So let me give you an example. If you have 3 factorial times 4, that's the same as 4 times 3 times 2 times 1, which is the same as 4 factorial. So if you have the next term, it just gets rolled into the factorial notation. So that's k plus 1 factorial square k plus 2. That's it. That's the right-hand side. All right, so therefore, true for n equals to k plus 1. Alright, so finally, step 3, conclusion. So just a simple one will do. So by mathematical induction, so I'm going to keep things short. True for all n is greater than or equal to 2. Done. So to summarize, so first step is to prove true for the first value, so which is 2 in this particular case. So the left hand side is just the first term, the right hand side is that sequence of n equals 2 substituted. Then you go with assume true for n equals k, prove true for the next one using the assumption in that first chain, so sub that in place of that. So that's that first step there. And just simplify, keeping in mind what you're trying to prove, yeah? I see a lot of students just like spend hours and hours on these induction questions, but They're just manipulating algebra aimlessly, and that's not what you want to do. You need to look at what you're shooting for and then adjust accordingly so you know how to manipulate your algebra, because there's like so many millions of different ways you can manipulate this, right? So you need to look at what you're proving. And that's the rest of the proof, just simplifying that to get it to look like the right hand side. Little tip from me in the exam, even if you didn't get to the result, copy in the result. Yeah, so for example, let's say I got up to that point, right? I didn't know how to times k plus 1 k plus 1. I'm like, I don't know how that equals to the right hand side. Don't panic, copy in the right hand side from the question and go equals to the right hand side and just hope for the best. Yeah, this is a very useful tip. You find that a lot of teachers, when they do mark it, you're like, oh yeah, I can see how you sort of got from there to there. You know, you didn't know, right? They probably just thought, oh, you skipped a couple of steps, it looks okay, and then give you the mark, and that's what you want. And that's it, and plus the conclusion. All right, so the next one, we're going to look at a different type, divisibility. Divisibility has a very different structure, but the underlying steps are still 1, 2, and 3. So let's see how that works. So first we prove true for n equals to 1. All right, so you sub it in. So that's 7 to the power of 1, so it's a 7 plus 5, 12, which is 12 times 1. Yeah, so therefore divisible by 1. Now, what divisibility means, for example, divisible by 12 means you need to show that it's 12 times some integer. That's what being divisible means, okay? So, true for n equals to 1. All right, so step 2, let's assume true for n equals k. So what we're going to say is equals to 12m, where m is some integer. So the definition of being divisible, right? And then we are proving true for n is equals to k plus 1. So we are trying to prove that 7 to the power of 2, k plus 1 minus 1 plus 5 is equals to 12 times some integer. Okay, so that's what we are trying to do. So I will just call it 12n, where n is some other integer, right? All right. So let's start with the left side. So I'm just going to expand the indices first. All right, so that's my starting point. As with all induction questions, you have to use the assumption. So I'm going to note this on the side how I'm going to use the assumption. So from the assumption, we've got 7 to the power of 2k minus 1 plus 5 is equals to 12m. So 7, 2k minus 1 is equals to 12m minus 5. Okay, so I'm going to replace 7 to the power of 2k minus 1 with 12m minus 5. So what I might do is actually do this a little bit differently now, having a look at the assumption. I'm going to look at the indices from a slightly different perspective. So I'm going to think of this as 2k minus 1 plus 2. Now, what that means is you can split it like this. Yeah, indices or addition of the indices means multiplication. And then I'm going to do the substitution in blue. So this part is the assumption part. So I'll just leave it unsimplified. See, 5 times 49 is 245 plus 5. Now, if you've done this right, that second term should be divisible by 12, and I think it is, looking at it. So factorize 12 out. Okay, so that's 12n. Since as long as there's no fraction in that second bracket there, it's an integer, because m was defined to be an integer. All right, so that's it. So therefore, true for n equals to k plus 1. Alright, so I managed to pretty much fit everything onto this page. I'll just very quickly do a step 3. So step 3, conclusion. So by mathematical induction, true for all n is greater than or equal to 1. Alright, so I'll just section that off. And that's it. So you can see that divisibility is actually a lot shorter to do. It is about, a lot of these hard, supposedly harder ones, is about manipulating that indices and then just get it to sub in from the assumption. And that's it. It's not really hard. You just need to know what you're doing. All right, so I hope that makes sense. Moving on. So this is another divisibility one, and this one is slightly harder because you've got a combination of, this is an inequality. So we've done in our divisibility already. Yeah, that's a very easy one. Inequality is one of the harder types to understand in terms of what you should be doing. So with this one, we are going to try to show that this is always greater than 0 for n is greater than or equal to 2. The underlying steps are still the same. So let's see how we do this. So step 1, we're going to prove true for n is equal to 2. So we start with the left hand side and just sub in the 2. So that's 16 minus 14 minus, so minus 15, so 1. Okay, 1 is greater than 0. I'll just write it like this. So therefore, left hand side is greater than 0. Okay. All right, so second step, assume true for n equals k. Alright, so assume that is true, we're going to try to prove that is true. Alright, so how are we going to do this? You're just trying to show that this is always positive regardless, right? So I'm going to start with the left hand side first and just reconfigure it a little bit. What you want to do in any of these type of reconfigurations is to try to use the assumption, right? So I'm just going to split that as 4 times 4 to the power of k minus 1, see, minus 7k minus 7. Yeah, so that would be the easiest way to understand this. Now what you could do is something like this. Let's see if we can do this. All right, so from the assumption, right? We have 4 to the power of k minus 1 minus 7k is greater than 0, meaning if it's already true, you can rearrange it as you like, right? So it means that 4 to the power of k is definitely greater than 7k plus 1. So I'm going to try to use this logic, okay? But before I do that, I'll just simplify this a little bit more. So minus 7k minus 8. Okay, all right, so this is definitely greater than 4 times 7k plus 1. So all I've done here, I should have done it in a different color, is use the assumption, right? The assumption being 4 to the power of k is greater than 7k plus 1. Yeah, so 4 times that minus a bunch of things, this should be greater than 4 times 7k plus 1 minus the same thing. Yeah, all right, so then I'm just gonna simplify this. Alright, so we have 21k minus 4, which we can then conclude. Just realized I switched colors. Oh well, you get what I mean. Okay, so this is definitely greater than 0 because 21k is at least 20 or 21 times 2, right? K starting from 2. So it's at least 42. Yeah, so just note that down. So therefore, that's greater than 0. So therefore, true for n equals to k plus 1. And that is it. Okay, so again, conclusion. By mathematical induction, true for all n is greater than or equal to 2. And that's it. So if you know how to use the assumption with these inequalities and just know what you're shooting for, I think I personally really like inequalities only because you're not showing it has to be the same thing. You're just trying to show that it's greater than the other thing. So it's actually a lot more flexible in terms of the logic. You don't have to make sure it's exactly the same. But a lot of people do struggle with this logic. It just takes a bit of practice and just keep reminding yourself they don't have to equal. You just need to show that the left thing is greater than the right thing. Yeah? All right, so finally, I hope you're up for a challenge because the next one is going to be really challenging. So let's have a look. So this next one, it's difficult because it's got trigonometry in there as well. And I think that is why this can be a little bit tricky. So let's take a look how we do this. Now, I just noticed a small error in the question, but that's okay. So I think what this is trying to get us to do is use the fact that t is tan theta on 2, not just theta on 2. So this is the t formula, right? All right, so we're trying to use the t formula to prove this identity. Now, this is a very typical exam question in the sense that for these harder ones, they always have a subpart like this where they say, oh, prove this or show this like baby equality or baby inequality, depending on the question. And you will have to use that in your induction proof. All right, so let's do this. So let's start with left-hand side. So left-hand side, we have cot theta plus 1 on 2. Tan theta on 2. Okay, so if you use the T formula, then tan theta, you can look this up on the reference sheet, it should be 2t on 1 minus t squared. I'm pretty sure that's it. Okay, so I'm just also reminding myself the triangle, so that's 2t, 1 minus t squared, 1 plus t squared. Yeah. That should be right. Okay, so cot theta is 1 on 10, so it's just the reciprocal of that. So flip that. And a half tan theta on 2 is t. Alright, so I'm going to make this one fraction. Yes, I'll just times t and t, top and bottom. Add that together. So 1 on 2t. Alright, so the right hand side, 1 on 2 cot theta on 2 is 1 on 2. 1 on tan theta on 2. So 1 on 2, 1 on t, 1 on 2t. That's it. Okay, so that's how you prove an identity using t formula. You just apply it to both sides and show that they become the same thing. That's it. All right, so the next one, the induction one. So this is the big monster in the room. Find using induction for n is greater than or equal to 1, this thing is true. Okay, so what do we want to do here? Firstly, if sigma is not your thing, write it out. So I'm going to do that. Yes, yeah? So I'm going to write out the question. So I'm going to sub r is 1. So 1 on 2, 0. And the last term stops at n. Okay, so I'm just realizing this is not matching up. So as you can see, it's quite important to sort of check. Is that, hold on a sec, that's not right. Alright. So that's x on 2. Power 1. Yeah, that makes sense. Alright, so that's matching. The powers are different. Alright, so it's equal to, let's move that on the side, 1 on 2n minus 1 cot. Alright, like that. Let's move that here. So I'm not in the way. Okay, so then you go through your steps. So now we know what the question is. That's the question. Step 1. Prove true for n equals to 1. So it's literally should be just the first term. Now with these cases, so that's just 1 on 1, tan x on 2. With these cases, you will find that the first term should be incredibly helpful in terms of the logic you will need to sort of move from k to k plus 1. Now if you're like, after the first term, yeah, no clue, do n equals 2 as well. Just so that you can see how to move from 1 to 2 when there's complicated trig ratios involved. So right hand side, is equal to 1 on 2 to the power 0 cot x on 2 minus 2 cot x. Now, as you can see, they are not the same, and that is why the previous part is relevant. So if you look at the previous part, we've proven this. Okay, so I'm just going to note this on this side. Hold on a sec. Yep, found it. Okay, so the result was cot theta plus a half tan theta on 2 equals to half cot theta on 2. Okay, so what you could do is, okay, the right hand side looks like this, the left hand side looks like this, so I might just reshuffle this, make tan x on 2 the subject, so tan theta on 2 is equal to a half cot theta on 2 minus cot theta, so times 2. Okay, so from the identity, I'm going to change this. Alright, so now let's take a look at the induction part of this. So with induction question like this, what you want to do, especially if it's in a sigma form, you want to write out the sequence so you know what you're working with. So I'm just going to write this out first. So that's 0. And the last term ends at 1. Now with these type of sequences which involves trigonometry, it's very important to look at the first step, and that kind of gives you the logic going into n is k, n is k plus 1. So the first step, prove true for n equals to 1. So we'll start with basically just the first term, yeah, so 1 on 2 to the power 0, tan x on 2, so that's tan x on 2. And then the right hand side, sub it in. Okay, now you must be wondering, well, how do I show that these are essentially the same thing? This is where the identity from the previous part is going to be helpful. So I'm going to copy that in blue. So we've proven this as an identity. So from part 1, just copying that across. Alright, so you can see that I will try to make this the subject because that's essentially what this is. So tan theta on 2. Okay, so that lets us convert. So using part 1, we're going to convert that into cot x on 2 minus 2 cot x, yeah, according to the conversion. So therefore, they're the same thing. So therefore, left-hand side is equal to right-hand side, therefore true for n equals to 1. So that's how I'll go about doing this part. Next up, we've got prove true for assume true for k, prove true for k plus 1. So what I'm going to try to do is try to copy that expansion there. Yeah, that's good enough. All right. Okay, so now you can see that's what we're trying to prove, so we don't lose sight of that. So the second step. Assume true for n equals to k. So I'm just going to copy this expression. And replace that n with k. And then we're going to prove true for n is equal to k plus 1. Okay, so I'm just gonna cheat a little bit and just copy this expression. Okay, so you've got basically the sum of k terms plus the k plus 1 term. Okay, and we're trying to show that's equal to 2k cot x on 2k plus 1 minus 2 cot x. Alright, so starting with the left-hand side, right? So this part, just to explain, this part is your sum of first k terms. So it's your t1 plus t2 plus tk, and this is the k plus 1 term. So we're going to use the assumption on that first k term. So I'm going to do that in blue so you can see. So from assumption. Now, if you think about what we did for n is 1, right? We had to use the trig identity. So that's exactly what we're going to do. So using part 1, so if you kind of just steal the identity, right? So I've already rearranged it. And that's why n equals 1 is so important, just knowing. Yeah, how to do the conversion. So what I want to do is kind of make that and apply the identity. Now, the way the identity is and how complicated insight is actually kind of difficult to use like this. So what you can do is, it's basically a half angle relationship. So you can say that this is the same as tan theta, it's the same as cos theta minus 2 cos 2 theta, right? Same idea. So going to apply that. So I'm going to do that part in blue. So tan theta, so theta being that, yeah, is equal to cot theta minus 2 cot 2 theta. Okay, all right, so carrying on from here. Now you can see I'm actually constantly cross-checking against the final answer. I can already see elements of that right-hand side, which is perfect. It means, firstly, we are on the right track, and secondly, everything should cancel out nicely and we should be able to deduce the result. So that we've got 2 on 2k cot x on 2k. Okay. Alright, so then from here, I'll have to go on to the next page. So let me just copy that. Don't you wish you have one of these in your exam, being able to copy and paste, especially when, I mean, those who may have done binomial theorem, I can't even rub that off, doesn't matter, you will probably think, oh, I have to write this same line like 10 times. This saves so much hassle. Now, these two are essentially the same thing, so I wanted to just quickly simplify this and show you. So that and that simplifies into 2 to the power of k minus 1 on the bottom. So cancels. and you're left with these two things, which is the right hand side. And that's what you want. Okay, so step three, conclusion. So by mathematical induction, true for all n, I think it was greater than or equal to 1. Yep. Greater than or equal to 1. And that is it. Alright, so that was quite a handful, but hopefully this shows you a more extreme example and how to manipulate it with a bit of trig identity involved. So just going back to the prior part, so the first subpart, very common for these type of question, is to prove an identity first, and then the identity, so prove an identity first, and then once you've got the identity, you use that in your actual proof. So you can see we've used it in step one to try to show that they're the same thing, and that should give you some guidance on how to use the identity in the subsequent step, which came to this massive thing. How we did it is try to replace this using the identity. Yeah, so from that into that blue part, and then from there it's just simplifying and you'll get there. Alright, so that's it for today. Hopefully you found this useful. This little presentation, I think it's gone a little bit longer than expected, but hopefully you can see some easy examples, so the basic stuff, knowing how to prove induction on those questions, as well as the more harder extreme examples where it requires a little bit of manipulation. But at the end of the day, the answer is in the question, so you just need to get your answer to look like what's in the question, fudge it if you need to, if you're really stuck, and that is it. So don't forget, if you have any questions at all, go to our Facebook group. So you just type in Pinnacle Live discussion group, you should be able to find us. Any topic suggestions, happy to gather all your thoughts. And in the new year, we will definitely be coming up with more topics and more videos to help you out. Have a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Enjoy the festive season.